get on my street corner. So there's my first money, okay? All right, let's go.
Music holds the secret to know I can make you whole. It's not just a game of notes, it's the sounds inside your soul.
Stories with Rik Emmett. No, I'm Rik Emmett, and you're watching Road Stories with Alan Frew. That's it, Frew. That's it. Okay. I'll do your show for you. Don't worry about it. But you just missed a spot. Just that one there.
Thanks, Mr. Emmett.
So what's happening?
So we're on. We're happening. Right,
we're rolling.
Here. So first of all, I should tell you that he's got his leg up. Not because, do you want to get rid of that?
Yeah, I'm gonna, yeah, I guess so. There we go.
He's got his leg up, not because he's being lazy, ladies and gentlemen. He has his leg up because he just had major knee surgery, right?
Yeah, but I can't claim to be some kind of a hero because this guy already beat me to it.
Yeah, I had it done. I was playing at Varsity Stadium in a dud soccer game against Iron Maiden.
And what a dud it was.
Yeah, and I popped my ACL, my medial collateral ligaments,
yeah,
and my cartilage.
Lord. brutal.
It's a bastard, isn't it?
Yeah, and this was, I'd waited years and years and years to get it fixed because it always seemed to be something I could put off. But last April I was playing basketball and I just kind of did one of these spiral kind of things, and I'd ripped meniscal cartilage and lateral cartilage, and I mean, it was just a mess.
I always had wished that I'd broke my leg.
Yeah.
I hear the story that if you break it above or below the knee, that it's painful, but you get it over with, right?
Yeah, well, you know, the thing is, I'm past the surgery now. I'm in physio, and you know, I'm feeling like, okay, I can handle this.
No, you're pretty active.
I have Percodan, too, isn't it?
Which always, yeah, that'll get you through the long nights. You are a pretty active guy, right? You like to play basketball?
I like to play sports, yeah. Basketball and baseball, and I coach a fair bit.
Yeah, you coach some of the kids' stuff?
Yeah.
Is that just, like, right here?
Locally, yeah. And although this year, my son has kind of got to the point where he needs a better coach than me.
Yeah.
You know, he's kind of outgrown me. And so he's moved up into a AAA kind of level of playing ball with the Mississauga North Tigers organization. And I'll be the cheering dad on the sidelines for the first year in a long time. But I do intend to get myself back into shape so that I can do some stuff, play a little pickup hockey and stuff.
Great. So how many guitars do you have?
I don't know. There's probably about 40 or 50 that are really good, useful ones here. And then there's maybe another 10 or 15 that are just sentimental. They're hanging around. And at one point I had like about 150. Yeah. And it was stupid. And I purged myself and gave some to school programs and some friends that had sort of always said, well, I kind of always had my eye on that one. And I went, all right. You know, so I got rid of a bunch. Because really, they're for playing.
If I used the word Canadian legend around you, would you feel that you've paid your dues enough to allow that to surface? Or does that kind of embarrass you? Because I do think you're a legitimate Canadian.
It used to embarrass me a little bit, but I'm getting very comfortable with it. I read a great thing where Eric Clapton was going through customs, and it was in Africa or someplace, and they look at his passport, and the guy has no idea who he is, and he goes, you know, and he asks him, like, you know, who are you? And Eric Clapton goes, well, I'm God. I'm a rock legend. The guy looks at him like, he goes, I'm a guitar player. He goes, oh, okay. Gives him back his passport. So there is an aspect of, you know, legendary.
There's so many young guitar players in this country that, you know, look up to you like the icon that you are on this instrument.
That's very nice, you know. But there's a thing about playing an instrument that if you approach it with the right attitude, it always keeps you humble. You know, the instrument itself will humble you. So even though that happens and people say, oh, you know, you're so legend, oh, you're so influential, blah, 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 that stuff is all part of kind of the business, which, you know, it's nice and I acknowledge it, but it doesn't really have anything to do with actually pursuing the greatness that exists, somewhere on that fretboard. You know, that's just a lot of damn hard work.
Right. Tell me a little bit about being a kid and why you're not a drummer today or you're not a keyboard player.
Here's how it started. And I think probably you've got some kind of a similar story, but I was in about grade 7, I think. And my grandfather had given me a guitar that had, you know, palm trees stenciled on the front. And I was a lefty. I liked to play this way. And I had learned a couple of chords and was, you know, desperately trying to learn Beatles songs and stuff. And at my school, they were handing out things in the schoolyard. You could win free lessons at the local Regency School of Music. And, you know, you had to name how many notes were in a major scale or something. So, anyways, I won these free lessons, and I went there, and there was a lefty guitar player who played right-handed, and that guy named Jack Arsenal. And Jack says to me, you got to learn to play this way. You got to put your strong hand on the fretboard. Mm-hmm. And that's when it started. That would have been about 64, 65.
But why the attraction to the instrument, though? Like, you know,
once I started having this, my natural left hand on the board, all of a sudden, within, you know, a few weeks, boom, I was way ahead of all the other guys.
Right.
So it was now, you know, chicks thought I was cool, guys thought I was cool, you know, and I was playing Beatles songs, and here I was rolling, you know. And so it was the first time that I started to realize, hey, I can be somebody. I can find the things that are sort of inside me, and I can get them out. I can on this thing. This is great, you know. So
and you can meet chicks.
Yeah, and I started writing songs right away so that I could sit in front of chicks and, you know, pour my heart out.
We did a segment on this, and I maintain that even if Sting was here today, or Bono, you know.
Oh, absolutely, those guys.
We always think of them as being so philosophical and, you know, and environmentally sound. Why did you get into rock and roll? Tell us why you get into rock and roll.
Yeah, exactly.
To meet birds, right?
Yeah, to do the, yeah, sure. Now, if you talk to Jeff Beck, he's right up front about it, you know. Whereas those other guys, they'd probably, you know, have some sort of deep philosophical kind of thing. But you'd have to get a, if you got a few pints into them, right, then they'd say,
now, have you met and worked with some of your, you're mentioning Jeff Beck and...
I've met many of these guys. I haven't worked with them necessarily. My creative life has actually been a very relatively isolated and insulated one.
Wonder. Part of a complete childhood.
Now, you must be very Beatles influenced, right?
How can you not be? How can you be a songwriter in pop music and not be?
Right, let's give them a quick 2 minutes. Now, we're just going to take it from, if I give, one, two. One, two, three. If I give my heart to you, I must be sure from the very start that you will love me more than her. Do, do, do. If I trust in you, oh please, don't run and hide. If I love you too, oh please, don't hurt my pride like her, 'cause I couldn't stand the pain, and I would be sad to find your love was in vain. We should take that on the road, man. We should join
a band.
Good.
He's got the John Lennon thing right down cold there.
I mean, is there anything like a John Lennon, Paul McCartney duet?
No.
Nothing?
No. I mean, you know, Simon and Garfunkel had their moments in their way, but nobody's had moments like that.
Right, I'm going to give you a quote. You can respond any way you want, but I'm telling you exactly how it was said to me.
Okay.
Okay? I was trying to dig a little bit on you, and I said to someone, will he talk? No. Does he still see the guys in Triumph? And this is what they said to me. Quote, only in his f***ing nightmares.
Yeah. Well, and there's less and less of those all the time now, too.
So, now, come on. I'm a kid, not age-wise, not far behind you, but I'm a kid thinking about rock and roll. Triumph are mega stars. Tell me a little bit about that, and then I've got to get you to the breakup and all the shite.
Well, it was just... When the band first started, it was one of those kinds of things, like almost any band, everybody's willing to make all kinds of compromises and sacrifices in order to get it off the ground. And it gets off the ground, and away we go, you know, and it really turned into this... I mean, second album we made was called Rock and Roll Machine, and it really was like a rock and roll machine. I mean, we had this huge touring thing, and we weren't a band like any other in the sense that we managed ourselves. And, you know, in the early days, we had our own trucks, and we had our own light systems, and we had our own effect systems. And still, you know, many years later, when those flashpots were blowing off and stuff, those rigs, we owned them. You know, those were ours. We had warehouses where we kept that stuff. So it was a very complicated, huge machine. And I was really only a vital piece, but only a small piece, because it was like, okay, little blonde, good-looking guy, get out there and you play your licks and look good and do your thing and go into the studio and write your songs and, you know. But it got to the point where after many years, I was in the studio and it was getting lonely, you know, like, the machine was starting to, you know, pieces were coming off it here and there. And everybody knows that when you're in the pop music business, you're going to get a ride. It's like a roller coaster. You get a ride for a while, but then it's going to be over. You know, there's very few bands that can keep it going forever and ever. You know, the Stones are a huge exception to the rule. They're not, you know, that's not the rule.
Had you all sort of, were you fairly established musicians that were brought together, or were you, like, we were kids in the basement together. Yeah. Triumph wasn't like that?
No, not at all. Yeah. Both Gil and Mike had been players on the local scene for a long, long time. They were older fellows than I was.
Right.
And, you know, they were very established in the sense that, for example, Mike's dad was the vice president of the local Toronto Musicians Association, and Gil was, in fact, one of the rock musician guys who'd been put on the board. So they were connected and they knew people, and Gil had a PA business that he ran out of his garage very successfully, and you know, and Mike had been involved in the jingle business for a while and with Hopi Records as a promotion man. So, and so people knew them and they knew people. As when the band launched, that was one of the things that really kind of got it going in the first place, was that they had connections, they could get little contracts here and there, little deals, away we go, you know.
So can we bring yous in a room together or what? Are you punching lumps at each other, or what's the story?
It wouldn't happen in the, you know, when it finally started to come apart, and when I said, you know, guys, I really think it's maybe time to hang it up, or at least it's time for us to, for me to be able to get away from it for a while, do some other things, function independently, you know, maybe we get back together again at certain points further down the road. They didn't like that. They didn't like the idea of me functioning as an independent unit, of having any kind of autonomy. You know, it was a very much control kind of thing. If I couldn't be under the thumb, there was not going to be any other kind of scenario. And I was saying, you know, well, I want out. And they said, well, if you want out, you know, you'll pay a price for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I went, well, you know, how punitive are you going to be? And it ended up being, it was like an ugly divorce. It was very, very unhappy.
You feel it cost you a lot financially and...
Yeah, and not just that, but personally too. You know, these were guys that I loved and trusted, and you know, we were partners, and we were like, you know what it's like. You're out on the road with guys, and you're living the life.
Mm-hmm.
It that's a bond that is very, very deep, and to have it sort of end up becoming as fractious as it did, you know, to the point where only lawyers would talk to lawyers, you know. And it just, that was really a destructive thing, emotionally. Personally, financially, yeah, but you know, in the end, what's money? Money is something that you do stuff with. You know, in the end, that doesn't matter to me as much as the whole personal side of it. So, you know, in the end, we just weren't talking, and that was it.
Have you been in their company and had any kind of awkward
situation? I have not. You know, at one point, I was at an industry thing, and I went up to Mike's wife and struck up a conversation with her, and she wouldn't even look at me. And I said, geez, you know, like, maybe I got some problems with your husband, but, you know, but she said, no, you're sort of like a non-person. I go, okay. So those guys were the ones that kind of wrote the book on how it was going to play out.
Right.
So that's the way it ended up.
Every day is an endless train. You got to ride it to the end of the line. Just be a troubleshooter, blow the bad luck away, and you will make it to your station on time. And you'll find out every trick in the book, and that there's only one way to get things done. You'll find out the only way to the top is looking out for number one. Is a different game. We gotta work for our fortune and fame. Success is a ladder, take a step at a time, and then the people will remember your name. Yeah, I found out all the tricks of the trade, and that there's only one way to get things done. I found out the only way to the top is looking out for number one. And that's him, we're looking out for number one.
Take it, Rick. Rick.
Excuse me.
I'm in a hurry.
Well, we might be able to help.
I'm always in a hurry.
Down payment and no interest. Come home to the Brick, the mattress experts.
Who will help you write the pages in the story of your life? And who will promise you tomorrow? Every single time we kiss goodnight, who will love you always and forever as we face this crazy world together? Who will make you smile through your tears and who'll share all your secret fears? Who wake up beside you when each morning comes? Oh, let me be the one. Let me be the one your heart will know, the partner of your soul, the one who laughs and cries with you, the one who lives and dies for you, the only one you need to share your hopes and dreams, darling.
You have a 25-year marriage and going strong, right? Four kids.
Four kids, yeah.
How does one survive in rock and roll and keep a marriage together for 25 years?
Well, I think it's sort of equal parts having a certain kind of discipline and a certain kind of humility. I'm not the kind of guy that got into rock and roll because I wanted to be a big rock star. And I think if you are that kind of a personality, you know, there's front men, you know, that I've met in my travels, you know, people like David Lee Roth, for example, and he got into it because he wanted the lifestyle. That was the big thing, you know. And he was probably the kid in grade five that was standing up mm-hmm. on his desk, mm-hmm. you know, eating glue. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, just class clown, you know. And I always wanted to be somebody that got up and said, no, check out what I can do here. Check out how I play. Check out this song. And let me impress you with you know, the hard work that I've done to get to this point where I think I can entertain you. And that was the way I thought I could wield power. It wasn't a question of, you know, dye my hair purple and make it stand straight up. Although, you know, Triumph had its aspects of it. There were a few lasers that shot out of my butt.
Right.
Over the course of this. But, you know, anyways.
I'm just glad I never get into that kind of rock icon-y, sticky up here kind of thing, you know. Never.
No, you never get into
it. Anyway, so continue. No stupid videos for me.
No, of course not. No.
So
anyways, I mean, we all went through the big hair.
25 thing, years of marriage.
Yeah, well, I think that's part of it. So my personality, my character was not such that I was out there, you know, looking to put my marriage in jeopardy. You know, I was looking to be out there, make my paycheck, you know, play my gigs, be a professional, bring the paycheck home. Say, hey, honey, you know, look what I got. Let's go on a holiday. Let's buy a new couch, you know.
Right. The name of the show is Road Stories, right? I know you've probably got a ton of them, but can you give me, because there's one standout, like a really...
So, most embarrassing moment on stage had to be Philadelphia Spectrum, a sold-out show. I had this brand new, very sort of electric blue kind of looking t-shirt. And, you know, sleeves were like French cut, and it was kind of billowy. And I had these really, really tight white pants, and I, you know, tucked it in. And I was feeling like I was Mr. Somebody, you know. So at the beginning of the show, kaboom, kabang, the flash pots go, you know, off the curtain goes, and we come roaring down the ramps and right to the front lip of the stage, and the crowd is always screaming and on their chairs. You know, we just blew off like 45 pots all at once. So, you know, they're all just checking their fillings and screaming. So I come down, and there's chicks right in front of me. There's about five of them, and they are really wailing at me, just screaming. And I'm going, yeah, and I'm doing the rock star poses, you know, and I'm spreading my legs good and wide, and the flying V guitar, you know, oh, hey, you know. And we finished the song, and, you know, crowd screaming and stuff, and these girls are still like, Daddy! Daddy! And I walk to the front of the stage, and I look down, and I go, what are you, I can't, you know, what? And they go, your fly is open! And I looked down, and the pants were so tight that I ripped the zipper. Now, the blue t-shirt's tucked in, so the blue, electric blue thing is sticking out like a flag, and it's waving around. As my friend Ian Thomas once said, it looked like some kind of origami penis, right? So I go, ah! What are you going to do? This has to be the most embarrassing thing. And so, you know, I mean, I kind of put my guitar there, I turn around, I walk back, I'm going to the roadies, find me some friggin', yeah, you know, we gotta get me some duct tape.
Let me tell you all a story about a journey off the beaten path. A man who made his way out there and never bothered coming back. People call him strange, they call him one of a kind. He would say, it's just a state of mind, Mr. Bebop. Swinging from the eels, only knows one way to play, Mr. Bebop. Come and chase the blues away, yeah. Or call him old-fashioned man, he couldn't care less. Cause where the music takes him tonight is surely anybody's guess. Oh yes, he can always offer you a guarantee. Gonna find those notes that can set you free, Mr. Bebop. Swinging from the heels, only knows one way to play, Mr. Bebop. Come and chase the blues away. Ba-ba-doo-da-doo-ya-da-da-bum-ba-ba-ba-dee-da-doo. Oh yes, he can always offer you a guarantee. Gonna find those notes that can set you free. Oh, Mr. Bebop, swinging from the heels, only knows one way to play, Mr. Bebop. Come and chase the blues. Every time he makes an offer, I can have the fools put me on the list. Whenever Mr. B is bopping the blues away. Yeah.
Road stories like me, then you can go to www.sonicnotes.com.
This is the story of a boy who just didn't get mad.
You may have seen this already. We messed with a busker today.
Oh.
I went downtown and sort of hijacked this guy's corner, and he freaked out at me. And I asked you if you'd ever bust.
No.
And you said no.
No.
But you have written a song.
I have.
About busking.
I don't, I've been working on it for a long time, right. Actually. I have it in my writer's book here that I keep. And, you know, without my glasses, you think I'm going to be able to cut this.
An open case on the boulevard. A sidewalk serenade. No need to worry about the bullets on the hit parade. Banging on a flat top, got an open market rhapsody. Trying to balance the need to belong with
longing to be free. I'm not looking for miracles, no songs outside my range. After all, the stranger's not so strange.
That corner over there.
I don't want you to go anywhere.
So you're draining me out.
But they can't hear me, and I can't hear myself playing over you. We're playing two different things. We're playing two different
Why don't we do it direct?
I wouldn't
want to. Oh, come on.